Would you run this line of code if it cost you $1 million?
$1 million.
Honestly, I probably would. But what if this was an actual scenario? Shopify is responsible for handling 10% of the US e-commerce market. Millions of merchants, $500 billion. The numbers are massive, and with that many transactions comes a lot of data. Shopify is known for its innovative technology and robust infrastructure. However, a recent exploration by the company's engineers uncovered a potential problem that could cost them a substantial amount of money. They stumbled upon a query that, if left unoptimized, could cost the company over $1 million every month. Reasonably so, they were shocked by this discovery, as they weren't aware that such an issue existed within their infrastructure. They quickly sprang into action, determined to find a solution that would prevent the query from consuming excessive resources and causing such a significant financial burden. All right, here's the backstory. A team of engineers at Shopify was responsible building a data pipeline for a new marketing tool they were planning to launch for those who own stores. To start with a small group of merchants, they needed a tool that could take in over a billion rows of data and could handle streaming requests from Apache Kafka. Hold up, little aside here. Apache Kafka is a distributed streaming platform that is used for building real-time data pipelines in streaming applications. It allows you to send and receive messages between multiple systems in a scalable, fault-tolerant, and reliable manner. Events are like logs of things that happen within your applications. For example, if I updated my profile picture, then that would be an event called Lewis updated his profile picture at timestamp, whatever. Now, at scale, if you have applications distributed in a serverless architecture, by the way, I have a video on serverless architecture, then you would need to stream these events in real time to calculate it. And this is where Kafka comes in with its event streaming. It's commonly used in use cases such as event sourcing, log aggregation, and real time analytics, among others. Perfect. After all is said and done, they wanted to deploy this large scale across all their customers. Think about this though, 1 billion rows for a small amount of users. How much data could that possibly be? Yeah, this is a little bit insane. So what are our solutions? Thanks to today's sponsor, Sneak, you can build your application fast and with the ease of mind that you're keeping your application secure for your users. Sneak scans your code and your dependencies for your applications against its massive vulnerability database to keep your app secure at every moment. Setup is extremely easy, as Sneak can integrate with your IDE, repository, or CI/CD pipeline so that you don't accidentally push that scary code to production. I've been using Sneak in my GitHub repositories to privately alert me and submit a pull request when a known vulnerability is found in one of my dependencies. Even better, it works with Docker images too, so you can find vulnerabilities in every area of the tech stack. Click the link in the description to find out why top companies like AWS, Google, Twilio, and more are using Sneak to secure their infrastructure. I mean, they're smart cookies, so I would trust them. Well, they could have done many things. One, just say screw it and let the trillions of events happen, and if it breaks the server, then blame the interns. That's what I personally would do, but I would probably be the intern and I would just take blame for it. Two, purchase extremely expensive servers to help scale the load of all the event streaming. Or three, look for an external data warehouse solution provided by a third party. Okay, I try to make the option sound as obvious as possible, but it's number three. Since they were already using Google Cloud and needed to rewrite results to Google Cloud Storage, they looked there. The software BigQuery came to mind, which matched all their criteria that they needed. They needed to atomically load the datasets in easily, handle 60 requests per minute without waiting time, and export the dataset to Google Cloud Storage easily. Awesome, cool. But what is BigQuery? BigQuery is part of the Google Cloud set of software that stores your data in a data warehouse and gives you the ability to store and query petabytes of data within seconds. Petabytes of data, folks, with a P. Imagine a library that had 500 billion pages of books, walking up to the librarian and asking for a super specific page, and they grab it immediately behind them. Everything sounds perfect, so they went ahead and they started working on it. All's good. Right? Okay, this is the part that you wanted to hear. The query that they wanted to do would cost them $1 million per month. But How? When they ran the query, they were billed 75 gigabytes of data being scanned.
So wait, what does this even mean? 75 gigabytes of data scanned? How does that even make sense?
Come here, let me show you something.
Okay, here we go. You hear buzzwords all the time like the cloud, let's migrate to the cloud, old man yelling at a cloud.
But like, what does that even mean?
The cloud is supercomputers all around the world that leverages the power and infrastructure from big tech companies to offer businesses with easier startup costs.
But like, how much cheaper?
Well, take this into consideration. How much would it cost to buy expensive servers, advanced security, distribute these across the world, and have people manage them?
It's a rhetorical question. It's really, really expensive.
That's why the cloud makes sense for a lot of businesses. You get these technologies, but you only pay for what you use.
Now, if I want to boot up a server to run a simple task and then shut it down 2 hours later,
I only pay for the 2 hours of server time it was up.
So, great. Cloud must be pretty awesome then. Well, apart from the downtime, vendor lock-in, and most importantly, cost.
Speaking of which, since BigQuery charges you by data process per query.
Sorry about the emphasis on per.
The math showed a devastating number. If you do 60 requests per minute times 60 minutes per hour times 24 hours per day times 30 days a month, you would get close to 2,600,000 queries per month. With the 75 gigabytes of data mentioned before, this would be 194,400,000 gigabytes per month.
We're gonna need a bigger boat.
Meaning BigQuery would have charged them $949,218.75 per month.
Okay, let's see what's in my wallet. No cloud resources for me.
If you're a really small business or startup, the cloud is one of the best places to put your technology.
The cloud offers extremely cheap or free services for your business so that you can start with low startup costs and iterate over your application fast, because we know a lot of these ain't making money.
Even if you're an old brick and mortar shop, transforming your business into becoming a modern marketplace, you have massive savings that can be translated over to the cloud.
Means you don't gotta buy those server racks. However, let's talk about the whales.
And when I mean whales, I mean Netflix, Airbnb, and more. Netflix and Airbnb both predict that by 2027, they will spend billions,
with a B,
on their AWS costs. For engineers like Calvin, who wrote this article this video is based off of, you don't come into the cloud ecosystem expecting to pay nothing, especially when your data is 10% of the US e-commerce share.
Again, that's a whole lot of data. Anyway, let's go back to my desk. Okay, so here's how they fix this.
A very common way to organize data better is through clustering, which is when you sort your data based on the columns in your database tables.
If databases are confusing to you, I have another video on my channel that I discuss more about databases, but I'll keep it pretty high level for now.
I can cluster information like data from today or data coming from Canada, etc. You can then use BigQuery to scan the clustered columns so that you don't have to scan redundant information, because that'll cost you.
Looking at the query, they analyzed the where clauses and determined they can apply filters in the query that would scan certain conditions. They also made it so that the query engine stops scanning once it finds the conditions instead of scanning the entire table.
Again, that would have cost them a lot of money. After creating the clustered dataset on the two columns with the where clauses, they ran and found that it showed only 108 megabytes billed versus the 75 gigabytes billed.
Wow. Insane. So to do the math, 2,600,000 queries per month times 0.1 gigabytes of data is equal to 259,200 gigabytes of data scan per month.
Oh, that's a mouthful.
Which brought the new cost to $1,367 per month, which Calvin wrote is way more reasonable.
Well, maybe more reasonable for Shopify. I still need to get my bread up.
Something I love about these engineering blogs is that it takes a little bit of vulnerability to show a mistake you've made and how you correct it.
Programmers can be absolutely ruthless. Trust me on that one. You should check my comments on some of my shorts.
In the world of software engineering, there are a lot of reasons that things can get overlooked or missed, such as deadlines, change of scope,
over or underestimation of complexity, and more. And with the cloud, you often have to get burned in order to realize that optimizations could be made. There's been many times where I've accidentally left my Amazon EC2 instance on overnight and had to accidentally pay like $50 or something. To be fair, much better than a $1 million query. Now, of course, axing your costs by 100x is a massive W, but they also made some other optimizations too. Avoiding the select star statements in SQL or SQL, whatever you want to call it. The select keyword determines what columns you want to select to query. The star is a wildcard that just means to scan all columns. Databases are usually pretty insane, so this could be like 100 or more columns long. So like if you're searching for names, only search in the names column. You don't want to have to accidentally be looking in the timestamp column for the name Lewis, especially if it's trillions of rows long. Partitioning your tables. You can divide your tables into smaller tables called partitions. You can do this based on a variety of units. In your query for information, you might already have an understanding of what range you would need. And don't run queries to explore or preview data. I did this once and I had to pay a decent amount of money, probably like 10 bucks or something, to look at data that I didn't even give a crap about. Whenever I read one of these types of articles, it always makes me think of the problems that big tech companies have to deal with. Every single problem you deal with, you have to deal with at scale. So if I go to caniuse.com and search up Ajax, which basically means you can connect to things without refreshing your browser, you can see that almost 98% of the global population of users can use these features. So let's do some quick math. If I'm expecting like 1,000 users to use my application, that means I should expect 20 people to have potential issues with using my application. I could probably go to those 20 users' houses and tell them to stop using Internet Explorer. However, with Shopify, 2% of 5 billion people who use the internet is a possible 100 million people who might have issues. The point is that almost every decision that you make has to be at scale. And similarly speaking, this team of engineers at Shopify is having to find ways to query an insane amount of data at scale, while little pipsqueaks like me can probably just do the wildcard statement that I mentioned above. If you want to see more incredible dev stories like this, you can subscribe to my newsletter, The Better Dev, which I have linked below. There I send open source projects and incredible dev stories like this directly to your inbox for free. Dealing with a massive amount of data can be really scary, and I think the roles that Calvin and the other engineers play in creating something that we often overlook is incredible. If you like this video, then you also might like my other videos where I discuss how Discord stores billions of messages, or how Instagram optimizes its video to store billions of different videos. I've linked the playlist below as well. What tech companies would you like me to cover next? Make sure you like, comment, and subscribe to become a better dev. Peace out, coders.